So in this video, we're going to talk about regulators of the cell cycle. We previously introduced cyclin-dependent kinases. These are kinases that help push the cell through the cell cycle. And these cyclin-dependent kinases work in conjunction with cyclins that activate them. And the cyclins activate the CDKs, and the CDKs phosphorylate substrates, pushing the cell through the cell cycle. We're going to talk about stopping the cell cycle using Cdk inhibitors, proteins that halt the cell cycle. So we introduced in previous videos how cells typically move from G1 to S phase via production of an increase in levels of cyclin D protein, cyclin D binding to and activating either CDK4 or CDK6, and that cyclin-dependent kinase will phosphorylate RB, the retinoblastoma tumor suppressor protein, allowing for the production of cyclin E protein, which will bind and activate cyclin-dependent kinase 2, which can further phosphorylate and inactivate the RB protein in this positive feedback or feed-forward loop. And that helps push cells from G1 phase into S phase. Now, if the cell sometimes wants to stop cell cycle progression, maybe there are anti-growth signals that are telling the cells we don't need more cells now, or something is wrong with the cell. There is DNA damage, for example. So there are anti-growth signals that can trigger the production of proteins that inhibit cyclin-dependent kinases. And these family of proteins are called CDKIs or CDK inhibitors. And it's very important to understand how they work and how they're regulated, because they are commonly dysregulated in virtually all human cancers. So we're going to introduce CDKIs or CDK inhibitors, which again, these are proteins. Now you might be thinking, oh, a kinase inhibitor, that's a drug, right? Well, there are pharmaceutical compounds that are kinase inhibitors that typically bind the ATP binding pocket. Here, we're talking about proteins produced by the cell that actually will bind to the CDKs or CDK cyclin complexes. And when these CDKI proteins bind, they will inhibit the function of cyclin-dependent kinases. And if cyclin-dependent kinases are inhibited, they're not able to phosphorylate their substrates, which means that proteins such as RB will not become phosphorylated. And if proteins like RB will not be phosphorylated, cells will not progress through the cell cycle. So that's how, in a nutshell, CDK inhibitors work. And in this video, we're going to introduce you to some of the CDK inhibitors, as well as how they are regulated. And then we'll talk about how they're dysregulated in human cancers. So let's go through some of the real CDK inhibitors produced by human cells. And again, as we've seen in previous videos, a lot of times proteins have multiple names due to the fact they've been discovered, identified by different groups, different research groups, or in different organisms. So one name is from one organism, one name is from another organism. Turns out it's the same protein. So you have these multiple names for these same proteins. And the example here are CDK inhibitors P21, P27, and P57. These are three different proteins, but you'll notice there are letters after their name. So P21 is a CDK inhibitor, also known as WAF1, W-A-F-1, also known as CIP1, C-I-P-1. So if you ever see this, it's just P21. That's all it is, which is a CDK inhibitor. P27, also known as KIP1. P57, also known as KIP2. These all can be regulated different ways. They can be produced at different times. But for our purposes, we'll just talk about the fact that they inhibit most of the cyclin-dependent kinases. So we've introduced the ones like CDK2, which binds cyclin E. We've introduced CDK4, CDK6, which binds cyclin D. There are other cyclins and CDK pairs. We've got cyclin A, we've got cyclin B, we've got CDK1. So these CDK inhibitors, these are small proteins that bind to cyclin-dependent kinases and inhibit their function, so preventing them from phosphorylating their substrates. And if they cannot phosphorylate their substrates, the cells will not move through the cell cycle. They will not progress from G1 to S to G2 to M. So these proteins, when they're active, will stop the cell cycle. There's another family of CDK inhibitors, which will primarily inhibit just CDK4 or CDK6. So they're not inhibiting the other cyclin-dependent kinases. These are called, these proteins are called INC4s because they are inhibitors of CDK4 or 6. 4 and 6 seem to do virtually the same thing. There's some differences in their function, but primarily CDK4 and CDK6 function the same. They bind to cyclin D. They help phosphorylate RB to get the cell through the restriction point. And so these proteins, P16, P15, P18, P19, they are all inhibitors of CDK4 or CDK6. So they primarily function in the G1 phase of the cell cycle. They will, when they are produced, when they are active, they will keep the cell in G1 because even if cyclin D is produced, if these proteins are present, cyclin D cannot activate CDK4/6 to phosphorylate RB. So this is another way for the cell to regulate movement through the cell cycle. We talked about before controlling levels of cyclin D. Cyclin D levels are typically very low in the cell in G1. When cells get a signal to move through the cell cycle, cyclin D levels rise through a number of different mechanisms. But that's not the only thing that's required to push the cell into S phase from G1. You need these CDK inhibitors to also be inactivated to let the cyclin CDK complex phosphorylate RB and start the process producing cyclin E and getting into this positive feedback loop. So this is another layer of regulation in the cell. All these proteins can be activated by multiple mechanisms, which we'll give some examples. So all of these proteins, these 7 CDK inhibitors, they can be regulated by many different pathways. They can be produced by many different inputs, help keeping the cell in certain phases of the cell cycle, preventing them from moving through the cell cycle when they're in their inappropriate times. On the next slide, we're going to talk about how these CDKs are inhibited. CDK inhibitors are regulated, not inhibited. Well, they could be inhibited, right? So CDK inhibitors could be active, they could be inactive. And I want to give you some overall senses of how they could be regulated. And then in the next video, we'll go in depth into some examples. So all the CDK inhibitors I mentioned on the previous slide, virtually all of them can be regulated by phosphorylation. Kinases will phosphorylate these proteins and change their activity. Now, will they become active or inactive? Well, it all depends. So phosphorylating proteins could activate them, could inactivate them, and it really all depends. But virtually all of these CDKIs can be regulated by phosphorylation, which means kinases like the ERK and the AKT pathway and other kinase pathways can feed into them and regulate them. Localization. These proteins are regulated via exclusion from the nucleus or import into the nucleus. So if you think about CDKs, right, these CDK inhibitors act upon CDKs. CDKs are acting upon substrates in the nucleus. So RB, the tumor suppressor protein RB, remember that protein is typically found bound to E2F and DP on promoters. So for CDKs to work, the CDKs need to go into the nucleus. So for CDK inhibitors to stop CDKs, CDK inhibitors also need to get into the nucleus. So a way to regulate the activity of CDK inhibitors is to regulate their localization. Third way that CDKs are commonly regulated is at the level of transcription. If the cell wants to halt the cell cycle, then it can produce, it can turn on the genes that transcribe and translate the CDK inhibitors. If cells want to go through the cell cycle, they can turn the genes off that produce CDK inhibitors. So you can play with the levels of CDK inhibitor protein by controlling their transcription. And lastly, you can control the CDK inhibitors via a post-translational level or stability. And we covered in a previous video ubiquitination, which can lead to proteins being destroyed by the proteasome. So again, when cells want to move through the cell cycle, they can destroy CDK inhibitors via ubiquitination, sending them to the proteasome. If cells want to not go through the cell cycle, then cells can stabilize CDK inhibitors by not destroying them, not ubiquitolating them, not sending them to the proteasome. So in the next video, we'll see examples of each of these mechanisms of regulation of CDK inhibitors.